What happens to a hedgehog if you remove its fleas?
David.
It dies.
No!
David, Davidy, Wavidy, Davidy, woo. No, no, there is a myth to this effect, but it's not true at all.
Yeah.
It's perfectly possible if you covered it with anti-dog flea powder, it would die from the dog flea powder, but not from the lack of fleas. They're very happy with their fleas. It doesn't kill them with or without. What mustn't you feed hedgehogs?
Bread and milk.
Exactly, bread and milk is a bad idea. People do that. It gives them diarrhoea and they dry out.
You really feed bread and milk to any mammal, including humans.
But there is a Radio 4 show that
deals... come off it.
Well, you shouldn't feed humans bread and milk.
No, not really.
What do you mean, not really? It's absolutely demonstrably fine.
No, it's not very good for you.
It's fine.
Bread and butter pudding.
I've been drinking milk and eating bread for ages. Why is it suddenly a massive problem? Oh, yeah. No, actually, we're supposed to live till we're 250. But no, we've been eating all this poisonous bread and milk all the time. We can barely live past 98. It's ridiculous. Of course we're supposed to eat bread and milk. Not just bread and milk.
Oh, poor Alan.
No,
don't bully him. Poor Alan.
It's not...
You shake hands and be friends.
Sorry,
now.
Alan.
Sean, biggest achievement in life?
Well, I think the money I embezzled from the RNLI.
That feels like something I could be interested in.
Yeah. Well, that time I went seal clubbing. They actually said that they've never seen anything like it. They said it was like a trolley dash.
They said that, did they?
Yeah. I had two hammers, hobnail boots. I was doing four at once. Or my greatest achievement must be rectum of the year. Not rear of the year. No,
no, it's different. Yeah.
This is rear of the year with the gloves off. I knew I'd won when I heard three of the judges throwing up behind me. I thought, I've got this in the bag.
Sure.
I beat Fern Cotton. Hers. Let me tell you, hers is pretty messed up.
Stop speaking.
And then, of course, that got me through to the world. So I went to the world finals in Cancun.
Cancun.
I thought I was going to win. I thought I'm going to win this.
Stop it.
And then Diego Maradona beat me. When he bent over, set the sprinklers off.
I thought it was sad, you know, that they had that pop concert to commemorate Diana. I mean, she didn't have much to do with pop music, did she? They should have done something that celebrated what was really great about her life by staging a gangbang in a minefield. Interesting to see if that makes it in, to be honest.
Susie has written 14 books about the derivations of words, and you can find them all in your local library. Just ask for the Sleepy Go Bye-Bye section. OK, Susie, what have you been looking into recently?
Other than glory holes.
Unnecessary joke.
Sorry, Susie. Okay.
Now, what have you been looking into recently?
This is all the effect of my having brought the...
No,
I've been looking into the language of doctors, which is quite interesting. Okay. But things like brothel sprouts.
Brothel sprouts?
Yeah, you know, doctors have these ridiculous names to try and... The black humour, sick humour, to try and, you know, keep the horrible stuff at bay. So brothel sprouts, basically genital warts. Sorry, I'm sorry to make
it up.
Yes, that's it, really. I can't. I'm just thinking glory hole.
I once set fire to my house with a box of fireworks.
David Mitchell, Stu.
Was this on purpose?
It was done out of ignorance.
What age were you?
I was somewhere round about 7.
I want to know where you grew up, where a 7-year-old can buy a box of fireworks.
I bought them in the shop near where I lived in Middlesbrough. It was a box for 2 and 6 of standard fireworks. That was the brand.
Standard brand. That sounds exciting. Standard fireworks. Yeah. A normal level of excitement will be indented. For a bonfire night, you will forget.
But it says standard, but then it's...
That is standard for a firework.
So you're in your home, and you're 7 or 8 years old.
I'm 7, and I'm on my own, yeah.
On your own?
Yeah, and
what
it was on one of the fireworks, I think it was the sparklers, it said, not suitable for indoor use. Mm-hmm. Which, at that age, makes you think, that means they're OK.
Could you just not read the word not when you were a boy?
Did you think not was the brand? You go, oh, lovely. I love that not brand food. It's not for human consumption.
I know that logic that says, well, people have obviously tried them indoors.
I've discovered just... they're not suitable.
Yeah.
So therefore, I won't use them indoors because I want to live.
If you look at a big firework, it won't say not suitable for indoors. It's obvious.
Yeah. Right.
But
well,
on the sparklers,
everybody.
They chose to put it on.
So what happened?
I lit the sparkler. The sparks went into the box of fireworks, a standard box, and set them off. And I carried the box of fireworks, now beginning to light, into the kitchen, and I threw them into the kitchen. I thought it would be more suitable.
I think you're right. The kitchen, of all the rooms, is the most suitable for fireworks, isn't it?
Because of the oven, the gas, the stove. There is fire, naturally, in the kitchen.
Yeah, there's a lot of... And there's more... It's more wiped down.
Yes.
Less cloth.
So what happened then?
They went off in the
What
kitchen.
Was the sound like? Was it bing, wee?
No, these were only standard. And, you know, I remember, as I'm sat here now, wiping the scorch marks off the floor and thinking that my mum's going to kill me.
Yeah.
So I'm going to be in big trouble. Then I went back into the living room, unbeknownst to me.
Yeah.
I dropped one. And the living room was completely engulfed in flames.
It sounds to me that if you're on your own at home at 7, your mum's pretty laid back anyway.
She said, son, will you sit here and look after these fireworks?
Whilst I
pop out to the bingo.
So, you lit the sparkler. A spark went into the standard box.
Yes.
The box starts to go, you go, uh-oh, I must get them into the most suitable room for fireworks.
Yes.
Kitchen. No need to go beyond the kitchen to the outdoors.
Yeah. Mum said, don't go out.
It's good to know there was at least one rule in your house.
What time of day did all this happen?
This happened mid-afternoon.
Oh, dear, so you didn't really get the benefit of it.
Who put the fire out?
I went to next door where Miss Best lived. She was, bless her, she was about 80. And I knocked on their door and said, my house is on fire. And she said, do you know, I thought it was.
So what happened then?
She called the fire brigade. They fired their water hoses throughout the house.
Yes.
Ruining it.
Even the rooms where there's
not
no fire.
Not ruining it.
Yeah.
You do know that before they put out fires, it's already ruined, don't you?
Lee.
You're making this house all wet. It was lovely and warm. Lee.
And it's the water damage that lacquers the house.
Which, is it? Not the fire?
Not the fire. If they would use their boots to put it out. Honestly, the entire house, that's it. I was in a family of 4 children. And we were homeless.
Where? Bob,
Keep it light.
No, I'm just saying.
Where were all the other kids while you were alone with the fire? Why did you take three
they
children
They were looking
out
after fireworks
you?
In other people's houses.
So when you say you were homeless, how much of the house did the inferno claim?
It's gone. Entire house
what, the
gone.
Whole
house gone. Yeah.
The whole house
burnt down.
Burnt down.
So how much did you leave in the living room? The fireworks in the kitchen have only caused a few scorches.
Yeah.
What did you leave in the living room?
And now, don't you feel stupid for saying standard fireworks?
Yeah. I
tell
not
you,
really. Well, I think you were stupid. They light a sparkler indoors.
If you don't know what you dropped in the living room, is there a chance that it's just a coincidence?
No, it could be.
Then it might not have been your fault.
That's what I said to the press.
It's not your fault.
Press? What press? Who did you speak to?
Local press.
Because they came to the house while it was burning?
Yeah, you know, they're their hats on, trilbies, sniffing around.
With those little bits of paper in the notebook. Were they called things like Scoop McLean?
I believe he was called Ron Waffle.
Sorry, Ron Waffle.
It was either him or the other ace reporter on the Gazette was John Caramel. It was one of them two.
Caramel and Waffle.
Honestly.
The question is whether you think Bob has been telling the truth.
Well, I thought it seemed very plausible until we heard about Caramel and Waffle. I think he thinks he's telling the truth, but I think what's happened at some point, he's seen a film in which this has happened.
He saw backdrop.
And is now convinced that it happened to him. I think it's a lie.
Vera.
I was going to say I want it to be true, but that sounds really horrible. I think it might be true.
Well, I think it's true. I think it's true.
So you're going to go for true?
Yeah.
OK, Bob, were you telling the truth or were you telling a lie?
I was telling the truth.
Oh.
What weird modern-day inventions have been in the news this week?
There's a bracelet they've invented that shocks you if you don't go to the gym when you said you were going to go to the gym.
Yes, it's a wristband, a Pavlov wristband, and it gives you a motivational zap if you haven't. It tells you GPS-wise. It senses that you're in the gym or wherever you said you're going to be or at the meeting you're supposed to be at, and it gives you an electric shock if you're not.
Don't think motivational and zap go together, really, do they?
It's basically a watch for masochists, isn't
yes,
it?
Is it?
You know, it's like, I've been a bad boy. Oh, I don't think I've quite been bad enough. Turn it up a bit more. Oh, I wonder if I put this on my penis, how this is going to work.
You wouldn't need to.
Just make sure you're not down to 2%, you'll be all right.
You're saying if you go to the wrong website, it'll give you a little shock so you don't go on the website.
Yes,
but
surely
if you go on a website that you shouldn't really be on, you just delete history, don't you? I mean, the tricky bit is not deleting history. The tricky bit is then going on all the innocuous websites afterwards so as it doesn't look like you've deleted history. That's the tricky bit, isn't
history
it?
History seems to be very empty in this computer because yeah, I saw you on it all leaving yesterday.
Yeah, yeah. I never touched the delete
I've never asked like that, yeah. Yes. Private browsing, Andy, private browsing. my favourite member of the Army Corps, private browsing. Good afternoon, private browsing. Are you on duty again? I certainly am, Dara. I shall be protecting you from any inappropriate sites. Private browsing, reporting for duty. Pants down, private browsing in here.
I shall protect your browsing while you shop for gifts for your wife. that is apparently what private browsing was invented for.
I love that. Oh, I mean, I've got private browsing on because I'm shopping for some gifts for my wife. Oh, really? You seem to be buying her pornography. Are you sure this is the gift she particularly wants? Private browsing! Reporting for
she duty. Told me that her favourite film as a child was Double Fist and Fist.
Private browsing has never had to work under these conditions before. He's mainly used for shopping for gifts.
Private browsing is retraining as an electrician.
Why did you leave the army? I saw some things.
You weren't there, man.
You weren't there. You didn't see what I saw. The first casualty of war, my friend. Private browsing, the first casualty of war is innocence. Private browsing. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I don't know why I'm doing it like Benny Hill. I'm Bethany, at your service.
Madam.
Benny Hill would do... No, it'd be like, you know, the paperclip that would appear. It seems
like this. It looks like you're buying some pornography.
Would you like to help with that? A small animated soldier came out and said, do you want to look at the porn? Private Brothers are going to help you with that. I'm amusing myself here. It's the last recording of a long summer, you know? Literally, I've got to enjoy this because in 3 days' time I'll be going, over the next 12 weeks, 20 candidates will be putting this up on Instagram. Sugar.
Private Branching's going to get some visits.
He's going to get some fucking hammering.
I think your penis is going to get some corporal punishment.
There'll be some major damage. And general recklessness. What do you dread and Colonel Abrams?
That was it.
Sorry, we'll bring it back.
Lost it.
Stop. Colonel Abrams is great, though. None of you remember... Do any of you even remember Colonel Abrams? Anyway, he sang a song called Trapped. It was really good.
I can't get out. I'm like a fool, I'm in a cage.
I'm like a man in a cage. I'm so in love with you, love with you, love with you. Sorry, you're not going to carry on with the show? Whatever.
You boys have got a shared past. We can only imagine that.
The point is going to end here today.
Johnny, what's your plan?
I don't want to do, man.
You've got to do yours.
No, I don't want to do it. I tried a bit too hard.
You're among friends, Johnny. Come on, do us your poem. Don't be shy.
Oh, no, it's going to be dead embarrassing.
No,
now.
Come on.
It's really long, man. It's not all of them. It's not all of them. It's a page.
OK.
I apologise.
Johnny Vegas, everyone.
In advance.
Don't apologise. Commit to the bit. Commit to it, Johnny.
OK, all right. It's about last orders. That's not for whom that bell doth toll as wordy barmaid's eyes do roll. A landlord with an earnest shout calls time on drinks and ushers out. The dutiful sup up and leave, but he's a last card up his sleeve. With feet like landlocked deep-sea diver, shuffles bar woods with a fiver. He begs the lass for just one more, and one yourself, just make it right. He promises to drink it quick, yet deep down knows he's feeling sick. Not from stout or bags of scratchings, more from questions booze keeps asking. What happened to the happy me? I think, no hang on, need to pee. In the bog the poet sways, poised to ponder fonder days. Before the time of cheap warm cider, eyes of wonder opening wider. Now they narrow, tired of fun, as fart turns wet and burns the bum. Yet Rory's smile pops in his head till urine runs down inside leg. And thus the landlord shows him out, the child inside is crying out. I was not meant for such sweet sorrow, but opts instead for see you tomorrow. Thou stout, soaked, sig-stained, feckless soul, is what for, not whom, that bell did toll.
Oh. I mean, come on. I think we have a winner. Come on. Yeah. That was heartbreaking.
It was about a friend.
Of the Acropolis, where the Parthenon is. They say of the Acropolis, where the Parthenon the is. They say of the Acropolis, where the Parthenon is. That they.
All been too much.
Turns out they didn't say anything at all.
They say
of the Acropolis, where the Parthenon is.
They say the Acropolis where the Parthenon is. They say the Acropolis where the Parthenon is.
better be good.
moving on. So, the triglyph is a remnant of the stone.
Sorry. Just got a question. What do they say about the Acropolis where the Parthenon is?
They say.
What are they saying?
He's going to say.
What do they say
about the Acropolis?
They say of the Acropolis that there are no straight lines. Damn that hurt.
Do they?
Yeah.
Whatever.
I once accidentally bought a horse.
Sorry? You bought a what?
A horse.
A horse? Sorry, I missed the S. You claim that you once accidentally bought a horse. Am I right?
You're right.
Right, fine. We're all clear. Under what circumstances? What did you think you were buying?
I never thought I was buying anything. I thought I was renting.
A horse?
Yes,
right. So you paid to rent a horse, and then at the end, when you tried to return the horse, they said, "What the hell are you doing? I've been trying to get rid of Psycho for years."
That's pretty much it.
How long had you imagined that you were going to rent it for?
We thought we were going to rent it for like 25 minutes.
And did they charge you?
It was in Bulgaria. On holiday.
Okay, so what did it cost in local Bulgarian currency?
What is the local Bulgarian currency?
It was...
We're going to
lose. It was 200 lev. Lev, L-E-V. I don't know how you pronounce it, but lev.
200 lev. 200 and how much is that in sterling, roughly?
Roughly, I
at
think
the time.
About, at the time, I think it was about £90. So you thought it was a good deal.
£90 for 25 minutes.
For 25 minutes on a horse.
But you said we thought we were going to rent it for 25 minutes.
There was me and my friend.
So you were
going to... It was a lad's holiday, we were 18, we thought we'll go horse riding.
In Bulgaria.
Did you question the odd sort of time slots they were going for? I've never been pony trekking, but I imagine they sort of rent you the horse for perhaps a couple of hours.
Or
at least a solid half hour.
You get 25 minutes and then the horse needs a break. For 5 minutes, and then somebody else
comes. And then
you
keep the horse forever.
Well, I never knew that.
What happened when you tried to take it back?
The guy explained to us that the guy was gone. The guy.
Explained to us that he'd gone.
Well, there was two.
Never say that.
There was two different guys. There was two
you
guys.
Go through me if you want to speak to my client.
There was guy A.
That's a Bulgarian name.
It's very well known. The most famous Bulgarian name.
Yeah. Guy Dimitri. I think that. No, guy A. And guy B. Right?
Right.
We thought we were going horse riding and we were heading towards the place where you actually hire the horse. The official. The stables. Right?
He's making it up, and I'm on his team.
Bit of patience, Brian. Come on, right. We met a guy on the way who had a horse, and we thought he was doing that thing in Asda when you've got a shopping trolley and you're taking it back, and somebody else needs a trolley, and you say, "Do you want that one?" So we thought the guy was saying,
"I need to go all the way to the actual stable. I'm from the stable,
yeah.
So just hire this horse."
That's what the guy said.
Yeah.
So we thought, all right, there was a bit of a communication breakdown. There was a Bulgarian guy trying to speak English and two Scottish guys trying to speak English. So we thought the guy had gave us the horse
to rate and come back in 25
minutes.
Were
you not surprised? That, I mean, I've never been on holiday to Bulgaria, but I imagine that things would be a bit cheaper in Bulgaria than in Britain. Were you not surprised that it cost you the equivalent of £90 to hire a horse for 25 minutes?
It was 25 minutes each, so it was two of us.
Yeah. Right.
So we chipped in for a horse. For 25 minutes each.
But still, even if you thought you were going to get 25 minutes each, that's a lot, isn't it?
Oh, it's an hour. You need to give the horse a break, as I said.
Let's forget about the 25
just
minutes.
Just forget about the horse. Yeah.
That's absolutely obviously bullshit. You take the horse back. Guy B, who's the guy you met on the way to the stables...
He's gone.
He's gone. No sign of him.
No, he's gone.
So you say to Guy A, well, we hired this as part of your not bothering to actually go to the stables but getting it a few hundred yards away scheme. We hired this horse for 25 minutes at an extortionate rate. Nevertheless, here it is. And what did he say?
We went back to the place where we picked up the horse.
Oh, so not to the stable?
No.
But to the random
points
in the road. So, bewilderedly, where has the mysterious man gone? I would have thought that logically, when you were returning, having thought that it had come from the stable, but you'd been lucky not to have to walk to the stable before hiring it, you might nevertheless have thought, well, the stable's where it's got to go back to,
yeah,
rather than, well, Sodom, this is where we picked it up from. I'm not actually taking the stable. I'm going to stand here, 300 yards away from the stable, going, come over here! Point locals start waving, going, no! You keep!
Kevin, look at me. You're taking the horse back.
Look at me!
What happened next?
Come on, Kevin!
Right. So where are we taking off from?
You're taking the horse back.
Let's go back to the start.
Kevin Bridges, for the love of God, please tell us what happened.
Right. We bought a horse. We thought we'd rented the horse. We'd done the horse riding, took it back to the initial place we picked up the horse.
Yes.
Locals explained we'd went to a counterfeit horse guy. It wasn't the official horse riding stable.
This was a counterfeit horse. This wasn't a genuine horse. This was maybe two guys in a costume.
That would explain the 25 minutes.
Yeah, yeah.
I can't only do 25 minutes.
The giveaway was after 25 minutes, they all went. Oh. Right, let's crack on, lads.
So, David's team. What do you think? Truth or lie?
I mean, the trouble with this game is it plays tricks with your mind. But I don't think it's true.
You don't really.
It's got to be, hasn't it?
It's got to be a lie.
It's got to be a lie.
Yeah.
Saying it's a lie. Right. So here we go. This really is.
Here's the moment.
This is more than any other episode I've done of this show. This is the moment we've been waiting for. Kevin Bridges, is it true or is it a lie?
It's true.
Unbelievable.
No. Can't look in yet. Oh, my God, no, Sean. You don't want to ruin it.
Oh, sorry.
It's an incredible game. OK, John and Sean, this is a bluffing game. John, in front of you, there is a red box. Sean, in front of you, there is a gold box. There's a carrot in one of these boxes. I know, it's exciting stuff. The aim of the game is to end up with the carrot. It's a game of bluff.
When do we do the conundrum?
Sean, stand still. That's fine. John, you want a carrot. Sean, you want a carrot. But there is only one carrot. Let's play.
Shh!
It's incredible.
Shush!
It's a brilliant game. Shush!
Stupid!
Stop ruining Christmas!
Henry told me.
Why are you ruining Christmas?
I'm not ruining Christmas.
Well, you are!
This is ruining Christmas!
Look at his little face, he's excited about playing. You've got to ruin it for everyone.
Yeah, I can't wait to win this carrot.
OK, let's play Carrot in a Box. OK, Sean, you can look inside your box. John, you cannot look inside your box. OK, you want the carrot, Sean. No, don't put no hands in the box. You can look inside the box. Have you looked? Have you seen?
Yeah.
OK, you now have to convince John to swap his box if you think he has the carrot, or keep your box. It's a game of bluff. The winner is the one with the carrot.
Oh, I'll keep this.
Do you want to swap or not? I mean, he seems confident there's a carrot in there. He's seen the floor in this
Jimmy's
game.
Jimmy's plowing on.
What do you mean Jimmy's plowing on? It's my job. Is Sean bluffing? Does he have a carrot in his box?
It's a real quandary for me, Jimmy, this.
Well, he can choose another box.
Yeah, he's allowed to swap if he wants to swap.
But can't I just keep my box?
No, he can swap if he wants to swap.
Well, I can refuse to swap it.
No.
You can't make somebody swap something if they don't want to swap it.
Have you ever played carrot in a box before? Have you never seen the show?
I must have been on holiday that week. It was allowed out.
Do you want to keep your box or swap your box?
I can keep this or I can have the box that's definitely got a carrot.
Yes.
I want Sean's box.
OK, well, grab Sean's box. Sean, let go of the box. Tonight. It's the nature of the game. It's the nature of the game.
Can I just say at this point, if there's no carrot in that box, you are a genius.
Let's swap boxes. Swap boxes.
Am I allowed to have my box back? Is there another round where I get to have the box with the carrot in back?
I'm going to level with you, fellas. We've never played this game before. We do not know how it ends. OK, so, John, you're now allowed to look in your box.
Right.
And I believe you can reveal... Point it the other way. Does it contain a carrot or
There's
not?
No fucking
I'm going to go and sit down now and think about what we've done.